Kirsten for the kind and warm introduction. Thank you to the Child Protection League for inviting me here. It's absolutely wonderful to be back in Minnesota from Florida, not running from hurricanes, and to be back with my many friends and colleagues from all the education battles in Minnesota. So I am extremely happy to be here and just honored to be helping such an incredible organization. My job tonight is to talk about social-emotional learning and kind of serve as a preface for Stella Morabito's talk to show you the dangers of it and what's wrong with it and what you can do. The big 800-pound gorilla in social-emotional learning nationally is called CASEL, the Collaborative for Academic, Social, and Emotional Learning. And they describe SEL as the process through which children acquire and effectively apply the knowledge, attitudes, and skills necessary to understand and manage emotions, set and achieve positive goals, feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain positive relationships, and make responsible decisions. The goal is to create a good student, citizen, and worker. Guess what? That's what parents are supposed to do. It is obviously very dangerous to have government entities deciding these standards and these ideals. The main components of SEL, according to them, are self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, responsible decision-making, including ethical decision-making. But again, the question you need to ask is whose ethics? And who decides what is an ethical decision? And how is that managed and monitored? Just to let you know, the head of CASEL is a woman by the name of Linda Darling Hammond, who actually was the terrorist Bill Ayers' choice to be Secretary of Education under the Obama administration, which tells you how radical she is. And just to let you know the ideas and the concepts that the funders of CASEL support, you have the Novo Foundation, who is into transgenderism and social justice, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, who's into climate change and health and equity, socialized healthcare, and the 1440 Foundation that's into Buddhist mindfulness techniques. Well, let's go over some of the concerns about social-emotional learning. First of all, even the experts and the proponents can't define it. When you have National Public Radio, which is hardly a conservative bastion, admitting just a couple of weeks ago that everybody supposedly loves SEL, but no one can define it, you know there's probably a problem. And then the Brookings Institution, which is a center-left think tank in Washington, D.C., does a journal with Princeton University, and they had a big issue in their journal about social-emotional learning, and one of the writers said, to create SEL standards and assess progress toward those standards presupposes that we agree about what SEL is, yet neither researchers nor practitioners nor policymakers have come to such a consensus. So if that's the case, why are they inflicting this on our children? In addition to not being able to define it, they also can't assess it well. We have few usable, feasible, and scalable tools to assess children's SEL from that same issue of the Brookings Journal. And then grit guru Angela Duckworth said at Jeb Bush's education conference in 2016, the measurements that psychologists like me have are so awful. They're fakeable, they're biased, and they're imprecise. Yet, we're still, so that problem with definition and assessment is leading to studies that they admit, these are one of the experts, they say there's still a lot we don't know about ways to enhance SEL skills. The results to date have been mixed, and there's a general lack of long-term studies. Doesn't that just inspire confidence? And there's actually a fair amount of contradictory research that says that SEL skills, especially in pre-K and kindergarten, are not predictive of future academic performance. It is the actual academic skills like math and reading and attention. SEL is generally insignificant as far as predicting the outcomes, and yet they are doing social emotional learning at a very young age. The federal government is pushing SEL through a myriad of federal laws and policies. The Every Student Succeeds Act, which is the replacement for No Child Left Behind, allows measures of social emotional learning in their school accountability plans, which is obviously very concerning. The NAEP, the National Assessment of Educational Progress, the nation's report card, and state assessments mandated by ESSA are starting to include SEL surveys that they're not even telling parents about, which is in violation of at least two federal laws that I can think of. The proposed reauthorization of the kind of data mining apparatus of the federal government wanted to have social emotional research funded and approved by the federal government, but thankfully that's been held up. And Head Start, which I'll talk about in a minute, and CASEL, this radical organization that can't even come up with good research, is funded by our tax dollars through the Institute for Education Sciences, this data gathering apparatus. The Obama administration was a big fan of SEL. Former Secretary Duncan said that grit, resilience, tenacity, and perseverance should be taught in a systematic way. Another huge danger of SEL is that it's inextricably linked to Common Core. I could give you multiple quotes from major national organizations, but this quote from Ohio Congressman Democrat Tim Ryan on the House floor when they were debating the final passage of ESSA, he said, "I believe this bill gets us back to redefining what the Common Core is." And remember, the Common Core was sold to us as highly rigorous, internationally benchmarked math and English standards. That was what parents were told and why we should accept it. Yet, he said on the floor that regulating our own emotional state is the core of what Common Core is. And this comes well before academics, science, technology, engineering, and math. That should be frightening. Minnesota is big on non-academic social emotional standards. In their Race to the Top Early Learning Challenge grant a few years ago, they said that they wanted to include non-academic developmental domains for children ages 5 to 12, so they wanted to expand it to preschool, which are bad enough. Rhode Island talked about, in their grants, linking both the state's K-12 data system with early childhood and the state's universal newborn screening and health data system. So not only are they doing quasi-academics, but they are bringing in health in this. And why is that a problem? Well, newborn screening is genetic data, and most states keep those blood spots from our baby's heel pricks and do research on them without parental consent. And they store them for a long time, and that's a real problem. When you have physicians like Dr. Willis, who said that general pediatricians don't have to be behavioral health specialists, but they can still intervene. Psychopharmacology is on the horizon as preventive therapy for children with genetic susceptibility to mental health problems. Newsflash, there hasn't been a single study ever to show a genetic link to any mental illness. A, and B, they would put mind-altering, potentially fatal drugs in the bodies of young children before they even show any symptoms. That is why we need to stand up against that kind of data collection. ESSA had a preschool component, spending another $250 million over another like 43rd federal preschool program, and it requires alignment with Head Start, and that in turn requires in 11 different places in the Head Start statute the use of the federal Head Start standards, which are like baby Common Core, and are even worse than Common Core because they have official social-emotional standards. These state pre-K standards also for state programs must align with Head Start and coordinate data sharing with Head Start. That's a big concern, and I'm going to give you just one example. The Head Start SEL standards, a child by 3 years old is supposed to be able to identify some physical characteristics of self, such as hair color, age, gender, or size. So we have the federal government doing a gender identity standard for three-year-olds. And just so you know, gender identity from both a national preschool curriculum called Making Room in the Circle and the Transgender Education and Legal Defense Fund is defined as a person's internal, deeply felt sense of being either male or female or something other or in between. Not exactly concrete by any stretch of the imagination. The United States Department of Education is continuing to promote transgenderism despite the Trump administration's withdrawal of the infamous Dear Colleague letters, and are allowing the Office of Civil Rights to get involved in controversies in the schools for things such as students or teachers refusing to use the preferred name or pronoun of a transgendered student, and different treatment based on sex stereotyping, and failure to equitably resolve a transgender student's complaint of sex discrimination, all of which are very subjective. So this is a huge concern. And I just wanted to give you this one example of an assessment that was done in a middle school Spanish class in Florida, which is talking about sexual orientation and gender identity. So it's creeping in all over the place. And now there are other major concerns on the SEL front. This isn't an official program, but it is a blog that I thought was interesting and disturbing at the same time. This preschool teacher wrote an article called Social and Emotional Needs of Students, an Islamic Perspective. And she said that creation of a cooperative classroom environment and establishing positive teaching is what our beloved prophet did. He established a community of support and molded his life according to the teachings of the Quran. He never used foul language, insulted anyone, beat a servant or a woman or anyone else, according to this teacher. But apparently, she had read Quran 47:4, which says, so when you meet those who disbelieve, strike their necks until you have inflicted slaughter upon them. Then secure their bonds and either confer favor afterwards or ransom them until the war lays down its burden. Muhammad brought out 700 Jews that were left in the city of Medina America after he captured it and had them all beheaded. So that may not be beating a servant, but I don't think that that's really a very peaceful way to treat people. There is also a federally funded Islamic curriculum called Access Islam that actually takes students through the five pillars of Islam, including the Shahada, which says that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his prophet, which is the Islamic statement of faith. And the students are required to read this and to write what it means. So this is not just learning about a religion, it is actual indoctrination or proselytizing, because tell me a single federal program or a single curriculum that you know of that would do the same with the Lord's Prayer or the Nicene Creed or whatever. You would never find it. This social-emotional learning is also tied not only to Common Core, but to digital learning, personalized learning, competency-based education, which is the next big wave in education. The Gates Foundation said that we believe it is possible with the convergence of the Common Core state standards, the work on new standards-based assessments, the development of new data systems, and the rapid growth of technology-enabled learning experiences to allow students to theoretically proceed at their own pace. But it incorporates Common Core, this data gathering and constant assessments. For as bad as the state once a year assessments are, these are even worse. There was a report by the Department of Education talking about the non-cognitive aspects of education in digital learning, including collaboration, persistence, leadership. That's code for SEL, and it's also code for Common Core. And they are really excited because learners will generate vast quantities of data. In fact, the CEO of an ed tech company called Newton bragged about his software that mines 5 to 10 million actionable student data points per user per day. And that includes SEL. This is all made worse by the fact that the Obama administration gutted the federal privacy law called the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act in 2012 to allow almost unlimited data mining without parental consent. And this kind of data mining was discussed in an earlier draft report called Promoting Grit, Tenacity, and Perseverance. And these are the types of instruments that they wanted to use while kids are working on the computers. Facial expression cameras, a posture analysis seat to see if they're bouncing and fidgeting, a pressure mouse to see if they're bored or frustrated, and a skin conductance sensor to see how their heart rate is and what their emotions are. When I and others first started talking about this, we were laughed out of legislators' offices and told that we were wearing tin hats. But about 3 years later, last year, U.S. News and World Report had an op-ed by an ed tech person who said they will also measure and monitor things like students' saccadic eye patterns as students learn from visual and textual information sources, data from sensors tracking facial expressions and posture, and more, and that they can monitor affective states or emotion. This is all from the cartel of big education foundations like Pearson and Microsoft. And this is due to the effort of workforce development training, which sees education not as broad-based academics, but actual just job training. And it fulfills Mark Tucker's vision, which Julie and others of us worked on many years ago, in his letter to Hillary Clinton about job matching based on the computerized data system, which would include all of these terribly subjective SEL things. They want to de-emphasize content over skills so that the students are, that they are more gullible and more malleable, and that is obviously not helpful to freedom. Video gaming in the classroom is another issue, and SEL and transgenderism are also part of the leftist effort to destroy families and religion. There is some good news. Congress is starting to listen to us a little bit, and the Trump administration is making some effort to revoke some of the federal interference in education. There's a lot of things that Congress can do, and there's a lot that you can do, including pray for our children, schools, families, and leaders. Contemplate removing your children from the public schools. Opt out of any testing and data requests. Regularly review and update your child's data profile. Fight at the local level to remind officials that these bad ideas have been rejected and withdrawn. Talk to your state and local officials, and thank you for those that are here. Talk to your members of Congress. John Adams said in 1776, driven from every other corner of the earth, freedom of thought and the right of private judgment in matters of conscience direct new Americans to this happy country as their last asylum. If we do not stand and stop this, that vision will be gone. And the final question we need to ask is, who will control the minds of our children? It has to be us. It has to be the families. It cannot be the government. So thank you for being here. Thank you for all your work, and thank you to CPS.